Welcome to The Missing Pages, where we explore science and history that you might not find in your average textbook. My name is Kouser, and my co-host Lee and I are scientists, meaning we spend a lot of our time being curious about all kinds of things, and the history of science is no exception.
Our understanding of science is built on thousands of years of knowledge from peoples all across the Earth. Yet, we're often taught that scientific knowledge comes from a very limited part of the world. That's why we'll be highlighting science and history from outside of Europe that have been foundational to our understanding of our world today, and have often been left out of the story.
So whether you're a curious mind or a fellow scientist, join us on this journey in uncovering the missing pages.
Our episode today focuses on the dissemination of science. How do we communicate knowledge and pass it on to future generations? How did we share information before the internet? How about before books? Or even before snail mail? Believe it or not, paper has played a huge role in science communication. Not only does it allow us to record information, but we can pass it on and share it with other people. This is why it became the dominant form of science communication for so long. But paper isn't the only way to record information. We'll find out that there are lots of different ways to store and communicate scientific knowledge. But first, we're going to find out what paper actually is and where it came from on today's episode of The Missing Pages.
Paper, we all know paper. We use it every single day for a whole lot of variety of reasons. I mean, think about all the uses of paper that you have in your home. But paper itself, well, it gets its strength from cellulose. Cellulose fibers are found in any plant, essentially. When you soak the cellulose fibers in water, okay, you macerate it down into microfibrils, and it's the interaction of the microfibrils with water. So essentially, the water latching on to the loose hydrogen molecules on the edges of the cellulose fiber that create what we know as paper. Now, when it comes to the beginning of paper making, we tend to look to China. Main reason is there was a gentleman named Seilun who took the edges of the long cotton banners that were being produced at the time, and he would soak these edges along with fibers and lay them out onto a woven sheet of cotton, leave it out in the sun, and then literally peel off a sheet of paper once it was dry.
So prior to colonization on Turtle Island, Indigenous people did not have the use or know how to make paper, but they had many other ways of communicating with each other. For instance, they were very well versed in using stone to communicate, and they used stone in a bunch of different ways. They used it as pictographs, petroglyphs, and petroforms. So pictographs are actually when you paint on a rock or a rock face. Petroforms are when you take rocks and you pile them up to indicate a shape. And Indigenous people did this right across Turtle Island, and some of the most fascinating ones are when they would make what we would call the medicine wheel out of the rocks. Another way they would communicate is through petroglyphs. And petroglyphs are when we actually carve into the rock. And right across North America and right across Turtle Island, we have examples of these wonderful petroforms and petroglyphs where they've carved into the rocks.
Modern papermaking as we know it today correlated, of course, in Europe with the printing press, the invention of the printing press. What I find fascinating about paper is, unless you size it, the inks that we use just tend to run. Sizing is what makes the paper nice and smooth and allows the ink to stay where you want it to stay as opposed to flowing all over the place. But the importance here is that you could, by using the printing process, print the same material over and over and over again. So you weren't relying on a single source, you were relying on the reproduction of this single source. So whereas scientists and researchers and innovators in the years before the printing press, so before the 1400s, would rely on a single piece of copied vellum or papyrus or something like that, that somebody had to sit down and reproduce using their hands and making mistakes. You could now have that piece reproduced multiple times with no mistakes or with the same mistake all the way through.
So at this point, paper is being used to make books and newspapers that can pass on and share information widely. Of course, this comes with its own problems because mistakes get replicated as well. In North America, they weren't using paper. Indigenous peoples were using petroforms, but they also had other ways to communicate and pass on knowledge.
You know, Indigenous people were very reliant on oral communication to transfer knowledge from one generation to the other generation. And in our literate society, where we depend on books and paper to transfer that knowledge, we have forgotten the art of that oral storytelling. We've forgotten the art of oral communication from generation to generation. And in many ways, we have this implicit bias against oral communication. And we always believe that the written word has to be correct, right? And there have been plenty of situations where we have found long histories that have been transcribed orally by Indigenous people, which actually turn out to still be true. Like we find out that the stories were actually true when we determine the archaeological evidence. And I'd like to give you a couple of examples of that. Many years ago, they were looking for an ancient village on the west coast of BC. And archaeologists, as you can imagine, were digging their test pits and looking all around because they thought there'd be a village here. And they had no luck for a long time. And finally, at one point, an Indigenous elder from a local community saw the archaeologists working, and he asked them, well, what are you doing? You know, what are you doing here? And they explained that they suspected that there was an ancient village here that, you know, went way back, like many thousands of years, 6 or 7 or 8,000 years ago. And that village elder says, well, I know where it is because it's part of our oral tradition. And he actually brought them, and he says, you dig here, you'll find this ancient village. And that's what happened. They dug there and they found this ancient village. And it was really incredible that that knowledge was still within that group of people over all of this time.
Hearing stories and listening to books doesn't sound that special, right? But these are actually powerful forms of communication that allow us to make discoveries and develop scientific theories. I want you to consider just how important communication is for our ability to build on knowledge from folks who have come before us.
Take, for example, Copernicus, who was a great astronomer in the 1600s, who essentially gave us our references for the way the Earth moves around the Sun and the interaction with the planets in the way that we know it now. He didn't actually go out and do his measurements night after night after night. He relied on other people's data that was printed in books.
Okay, sidebar. Those books that Christine mentioned, they were written by scholars all around the world. And Copernicus cited many scholars who also hypothesized that the sun was somewhere at the center of our solar system. This is a great example of science simplifying the credit for a theory and applying it to one person. We don't do that anymore. So books are super important for combining that knowledge and allowing us to move forward with scientific theories. However, our history books tend to write out a lot of the other names and scholars who were associated with Copernicus's theory.
So with the availability of books, we now have centers of education, so universities have series of books that are available to their students.
Our textbooks can sometimes rewrite history or leave things out, but you can always go back and reference them, which provides some level of accountability and accuracy. You can't necessarily do that with oral traditions. So one might ask, how accurate can they be?
there's this belief that oral communication isn't as accurate as written communication. And if you do oral communication right, and if that has been your tradition, then it is easily as accurate. You know, we can look across the Great Sea, and we can look at the examples that are coming to us from Australia, from the Aboriginal people in Australia. And this is a really, really interesting one, because for years, these Indigenous group of people in Australia, they talked about a bird, and they called it the firehawk. And they believed, their stories were that this bird would wait for a lightning strike, and then would carry a flaming ember in its mouth, and would fly over a woods, and it would drop the ember in the woods. And when that woods caught fire, the hawk would wait, and all the little animals that were escaping, he would swoop in and catch the animals and eat them. And of course, all the scientists and all the archaeologists said, well, that's a wonderful myth you have, that's a wonderful story, but it is a story, because this has never been documented in any bird anywhere, that this is not happening, it couldn't be happening. While lo and behold, in the last 20 or 30 years, scientists actually discovered it happening. They actually watched as a hawk did this after a lightning struck a grass fire, and the hawk took it away and flew it into the woods to start another fire. And all of a sudden it was, oh, maybe we are wrong. There is such thing as a fire hawk.
So historically, there's always been people who have access to information and people who don't have access to information. The people with access are people in power, or people in the know, or people who are actually doing the studying. If you couldn't read, did not have access to education, did not have access to public libraries, did not have ready access to published materials, whether they be newspapers or magazines or actual textbooks, you weren't getting that kind of information.
To me, one of the disservices that written writing and that written, you know, the written approach to things, one of the disservices that it has done to Indigenous people in both North America and South America was perpetuating the myths of sort of European supremacy and everything. And because of that, scientists and anthropologists and even archaeologists have not really been able to discover Indigenous technology, traditional Indigenous technology, traditional Indigenous design, because they've sort of been blind to it. And they've been blind to it because of this myth that, Indigenous people prior to colonization somehow were uncivilized. And that is absolutely not the truth. And I find that the words that we use to describe them, we use these words in order to not give them credit for all the things that they did and all the discoveries they made, right? And even today, I read about some of the traditional Indigenous groups in North America, and they call them, they were hunters and gatherers. And then there's definitely a demeaning sense to that idea that they were hunters and gatherers, meaning, well, they weren't farmers, so they didn't domesticate this, they didn't domesticate that. And it's untrue. It's not true. They did, but the Europeans didn't understand it. So the Indigenous idea of domestication was completely different than what the Europeans were wanting to see or expecting to see. So they thought it wasn't happening. And that gets written in the textbooks.
Science dissemination, whether it be through writing or oral traditions or other physical means, has a long and complicated history. So I asked Randy and Christine, if they were adding to a science textbook, what would be on their missing page?
Ever since we have been around as a species, we have wanted to communicate with our fellow humans, either directly to our communities for the future, or even to broadcast out to what could have been the world at that point. My missing page would have all of those links.
I believe that the missing page or pages of a modern day textbook should include giving Indigenous people the recognition they deserve for the advanced science and technology and engineering that they had.
Thanks for watching The Missing Pages. We hope this helps to give a more accurate understanding of the history of science and the wide range of peoples who continue to play an important part in our understanding of the world. Be sure to subscribe to our channel and follow us on social media for more content.